Anyway, I want to welcome you all to the Boston Chinatown Neighborhood Center's Power Art Center. We are a new center, opened in partnership with Bunkerville Community College in May of 2017. So still this year, but we're just open. And this is a really important partnership. And through this center, we hope to use arts education and culture to connect people across generations together here. This is historically a really important piece of land, parcel 24, where in the 60s over 200 families were displaced. And now we're reclaiming this history as an important part of Chinatown history and giving us a space for people to connect. So it's really important for us to partner with people like Arts Boston to present things like this. So thank you again. I should also say, welcome to the very beautiful Bar Foundation Theater. Sansan is somewhere. newly named, so thank you for being here. That's all I want to say. Housekeeping notes, if you haven't found the restrooms already, they're right outside the store around the corner. And with that, I'll introduce Catherine Peterson from Arts Boston. Thank you.
Good evening, and thank you so much, Cynthia. We are so happy to be here this evening. And welcome all to Paving the Way, a conversation with leaders of color in the arts, and followed by the Network for Arts Administrators of Color holiday party outside, which I know will be terrific. I could hear the conversation, the buzz that was going on beforehand, so there. I know there's a lot to talk about afterwards. Thank you all for being here, and thank you to our terrific panelists and our wonderful moderator. We have three friends that both I and Arts Boston have known for many years, and one new one who we're so happy to have here in Boston, so thank you so much. Arts Boston, you know, is an arts service organization, and the service that we are doing now is expanding and changing as an arts service organization. And the Network for Arts and Administrators of Color is part of that change, where we're working collectively to address the need for greater equity, diversity, and inclusion in the arts here in Boston. We focused on audience development and engagement for over four decades, and we realized that this work is not just about who's in the audience, but it's about who's making the programming decision and who's in charge of who's on the board and who's on our staff. And this is work we're committed to at Arts Boston in conjunction with the rest of the arts community and the rest of the city and region. This change takes leadership, and that's what the Network for Arts Administrators of Color Boston, NAC Boston, is all about: encouraging intentional conversations about representation, fostering an environment where we can work together to be better at inclusivity, and recognizing and supporting talent. And the talent word seems the perfect segue to introduce my colleague, Vicki George, who is the Audience Lab Director at Arts Boston, also the founder for the network. And Sansan, I want to add my thank you also from Arts Boston for the Bar Foundation support for the Audience Lab. So it is my pleasure to introduce Vicki George.
Good evening. We are so delighted to have you all here out this evening. And I will say that we might still have a few other people coming through, because I do recognize that it's a little hard to find the Power Arts Center. but we are happy that you found us this evening. So when I started the network in July of 2016, I really wanted to focus on a few different goals. I wanted to provide a space for arts administrators of color to convene. I really wanted to also make sure that we were highlighting and making visible these fantastic, fantastic arts administrators that we have in the greater Boston area. And I also wanted to be able to provide professional growth and opportunities for arts administrators to really move forward on the leadership track. Because we need that here in Boston, and we think that this is a really great and vibrant and diverse our city, but it's not always reflective in a lot of the arts organizations that we know and have come to love. And so when I started the network in July of 2016, a lot of us thought, well, maybe about 30 people at the most might reply and say that they would come to that very first convening that we had. 80 people responded. And it kind of blew our minds, but also really hit up against the assumption that there aren't enough qualified arts administrators of color in Boston, because there are. And we're up to about 200 people now, and it's all been really through word of mouth, so we are delighted to have you here today. So this conversation is the first in a series of three around leaders of color in the arts, and really sort of championing and highlighting and giving the Boston area the opportunity to meet these fantastic leaders and hear about sort of who they are, where they've come from, and how they've sort of maneuvered their way through the arts sector. So we're very, very delighted to have them here today. Before I introduce our fantastic moderator, I do want to say a couple of different thank yous. So thank you so much to Cynthia, Karthik, and Giles for allowing us and partnering us with us here at the Power Arts Center and the Boston China Hood Neighborhood Center. And also to HowlRound, so Stokely, thank you so much for live streaming this event for us today. I'd also love to thank the advisory board, because without them I couldn't do this work. So thank you to Adewunmi Oki, who actually moved to Atlanta, and she's helping us from Atlanta. To Chris Guerra, to Audrey Serafin, to Todd McNeil, Carmen Kadran, and Alenta Mitchell. And also, of course, a huge thank you to Bank of America, because without their support, it would be a little bit challenging to run this network. So thank you all. And without further ado, I would like to introduce you to Todd McNeil. So Todd. Coordinator at the Boston Lyric Opera, and prior to joining BLO, he served as the Marketing Fellow of Arts Emerson. Originally from Dallas, Texas, Todd has spent the last few years working in Boston as a classical singer and arts administrator. Todd is a member of the internationally acclaimed group, the American Spiritual Ensemble, and has appeared with Wildwood Parks for the Arts, Cincinnati Opera, the Princeton Opera Festival, Boston Youth Symphony Orchestra, Metro West Opera, and Central Square Theater. Todd has a graduate performance diploma from the Longy School of Music of Bard College and is currently working on his master's in communication management from Emerson College. So, woo!
Thank you, Vicki, for that lovely introduction. As Vicki said, my name is Todd McNeil, and I serve as the media coordinator for Boston Lyric Opera. Thank you all for being here for this very important and timely conversation. But before I get started, I wanted to introduce everyone to our very distinguished panel. So first up, we have Ben. Come on down, Ben. Ben Hires is the executive producer and chief strategy officer at Boston Children's Chorus. In this role, Hires is responsible for providing strategic direction for the organization, working closely with the board of directors, representing the organization locally, nationally, and internationally, raising support and awareness for BCC's mission, and overseeing all choir activities. Hires has held positions at the Boston Youth Symphony Orchestra and served as the executive director of the New England String Ensemble. Ben earned a BA in Philosophy and Political Science, a Master's of Theological Studies, and a Master of Science in Arts Administration from Boston University. Thank you for being here, Ben. Sure. Next up on our panel, we have Ms. Candelaria Silva Collins. Candelaria is an arts consultant, facilitator, and nonprofit professional currently serving as the chair of the board of designators for the George B. Henderson Foundation. Candelaria also coordinates the Huntington Theater's community membership program and is the program manager for the Fellows of Athenaeum Trust Fund for the Boston Public Library. Previously, Candelaria was director of three nonprofit programs, including Act Roxbury, where she conceived, planned, and raised funds for its signature programs, including the Roxbury Film Festival, Roxbury Open Studios, Roxbury Literary Annual, and the Roxbury is Rich Holiday Shopping Guide. Candelaria also provided leadership in the creation of the Hibernian Hall, and originally is from St. Louis, Missouri. Candelaria received her BA from Goddard College in Plainfield, Vermont. Thank you for joining us. And last but not least on our panel, we have Chris Edwards. Chris Edwards is an actor, director, and fight choreographer and educator, and the newly appointed artistic director for the Actors Shakespeare Project. Prior to joining the Actors Shakespeare Project, Chris served as the artistic director of the Nevada Conservatory Theater in Las Vegas, as well, gotta turn the page over, sorry, as the associate director and director of education and apprentice training with the Hudson Valley Shakespeare Festival in Cold Spring, New York. In addition, Chris co-founded the Point of Entry Theater, an education-based company dedicated to introducing inner-city youth to heightened text, both classical and contemporary, including Shakespearean productions and hip-hop theater adaptations of classics in collaboration with the Lincoln Center's Meet the Artist program. Chris received his MFA from the University of Minnesota in association with the Guthrie Theater. Thank you for being here, Chris, and also welcome to Boston. Right. So, as many of my fellow artists in the room, most of us can all remember our first artistic experience. For me personally, I come from a long line of gospel and blues singers, so my introduction into the performing arts world was growing up with my grandparents, going to church, singing in the 8 a.m. choir, the 10 a.m. choir, and if there was a 4 p.m. choir, we were there. And so fast forward, I went to college on a vocal performance scholarship, but my parents were always on my back about finding another program that was practical or sustainable. And so while I didn't believe that was true at the time, I picked up a double major in Mass and Speech Communications, and it was from that program and in those courses that I was introduced into the world of arts administration. Fast forward now, I've been living in Boston for 3 years, and those dreams and goals and talks that I had with my advisor 4 years ago are now becoming a reality, and I'm just now starting my arts administration experience in Boston. Knowing that about myself, I wanted to ask our panelists some of their earliest arts memories. So Ben, would you like to start us off?
Sure. Good evening, everyone, and thanks for being here this evening. Todd, I had two examples that I was come to mind. One is when I was younger, sort of like you, I spent a lot of time with my grandparents, and so I fondly remember Sundays with Sinatra. And so I think, you know, sharing that, you know, love of music with my grandmother in particular got me interested in jazz, and got me interested in big band and things like that. So I definitely recognize my grandparents for that. Sort of fast forward to college, I've shared this story before in some settings that I was a tutor and there was a fellow tutor that I had kind of had a crush on. And I knew she played the oboe. And I was like, oh, it'd be really cool, you know, really slick of me if I invited her to go see an orchestra play or something. I know oboes in an orchestra. I'm not sure where exactly, but I know that would be maybe a good move. So we went to, I was a BU student. And we went to hear the BU Symphony play at Cy Performance Center. Got there a little late because we were college students and had to sit in the very front row. And they were playing Rachmaninoff's Second Symphony. And so, you know, the evening was great. I was blown away by the concert and by that piece sitting there in the front row. And, you know, the relationship didn't really go anywhere. It was, you know, we're friends or whatnot. But what I did take away that evening was a love for classical music and orchestras and things like that. And so I think when the opportunity came to work at the Boston New Symphony Orchestra while I was a grad student, it was kind of a good fit. Like, oh, I kind of know what that's about. It gets me excited. It moves me to you know, listen to this music and help young people, you know, achieve that as well. So it kind of set the groundwork, I think, for my move into arts administration.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Okay.
So I grew up in the theater of the black church in St. Louis, Missouri. I was actually baptized in the Mississippi River. I've written a children's book that I'm trying to get published about that experience. So singing was a huge part of my life, but it was also blues and country music. One of my grandmothers used to listen to the Grand Ole Opry. Minnie Pearl, I'm just so proud to be here. I remember that. Tina Turner came on my street. I went to school with one of Miles Davis' sons. I went to school with Joe Bowie and a lot of people. I took dance lessons across the river in East St. Louis at Catherine Dunham Studio. I had snuck away from home and went to the Black Artist Group the night that Jimi Hendrix was died. And so it was just you know, constantly culture, a lot of music. The Staple Singers' cousins sang in the choir in my church. So there were just like all of that. And I remember also meeting Sonia Sanchez and Mari Evans and Audre Lorde that came to my high school. One of the things about the first high school I went was all black. It was a lot of people, this discrimination kept them from teaching at the college level. So we had a lot of people with doctorates who were teaching at our school. And so they treated us as though we were college students and made us exposed to so much. And I also remember going to theater at Loretta Hilton and finally seeing Nina Simone at a concert that she, and Sly Stone at a concert that he actually showed up at. So
which was a big deal because you didn't
always know. So when I came to Boston to go to college at Northeastern, the Bay State Banner had started a couple years before I came to college, and I literally wrote them and said, I used to do reviews for the black newspapers in St. Louis, can I do reviews for you? And that got me started reviewing theater and all that, so.
Wow, I feel like the odd man out, because you all seem to have had a very vibrant youth around the arts. I, however, did not. I grew up as a military brat, I was born in Holland, lived in England, California, Ohio, Delaware, Las Vegas. And my only connection to the arts was that I would go into my room and draw quite a bit. I was really into drawing when I was in elementary school and junior high school. And I was sort of that kid that would always win the little best artist of the seventh grade, best artist of the sixth grade. But somewhere around the time of high school, something kicked in for me because, you know, I come from a very blue-collar family where art was not a practical thing. And something kicked in for me and said, well, you need to go to make a living because you can't do this with art. So I forgot it from about ninth grade all the way through to my junior year of college. And what brought me back to it was that I had to take a class because I was a business major in undergrad, and I had to take a class. At the time, you had to take one arts and letters class in my whole curriculum, and it was like maybe photography, maybe acting. And so I took an acting class because I wanted to go to law school. I was hooked immediately, and it all just sort of came rushing back. Side note to that, I didn't at the time think I was doing art, but in high school, I was also a b-boy, a break dancer, and a backup dancer. And I used to step and do all that stuff, but that wasn't art to me because I had never had the nurturing of what art is. It was just a form of expression. It was a way for me to deal with my anger, and it was a way to, like, you know, get girlfriends. But so my junior year, I was able to get back to it, and it all sort of rushed back, and I was able to sort of connect all the different aspects of who I was as an artist. Fast forward about, I don't know, 10 years, I became an arts administrator because I was really big into working with kids from, you know, disenfranchised youth like I was, who had no one to sort of mentor them through their interests. And I worked with a lot of kids in incarcerated youth. And whenever the company I was with needed somebody to do something, I was always the person who would say, yeah, I'll do it till you find somebody else to hold the fort down. Then, you know, that job became the next job. Yeah, I'll do it. And then I, just doing that, I've sort of worked my way up to being an artistic director and an arts administrator.
Awesome. So, Chris, you just kind of touched on it, but for the both of you, Ben and Candelaria, when did you know that you wanted to pursue a career in the arts, whether it be through arts administration or as a performing or visual artist?
I always get frustrated by things that I can envision that don't happen. Mm-hmm. And so I just, and I, when I was younger, I didn't think that I couldn't do things for other people. It's funny, there are a lot of things I haven't done for myself as an individual, but I could always do something for a group. And ACT Roxbury, which was a cultural economic development program that I was the first director of, I literally saw an ad in the banner for this new thing called cultural economic development that the Mass Cultural Council was funding. But I had administered other programs, but like I don't have an MBA. I'm old enough that that wasn't required so much in administration back in those days. But I clearly was very organized, very passionate, could talk my way into things. And I just say, we could do this, let's do this. And then I know lots of people, and I would invite people I knew who could do things that I thought would make a vision happen. So for me, it was like, why doesn't Roxbury have open studios? South End has open studios, why doesn't Roxbury? There are all these filmmakers in Roxbury. Why doesn't Roxbury have a film festival? Let's have a film festival. So that's always been sort of my motivation. And I think the precursor to that was I did a job for youth called Youth Rap at Roxbury. It was a joint effort of Roxbury Community College and Wentworth Institute of Technology. And one of the things I did was a speaker series where we had everything that any kid said that they were ever interested in, we had a speaker come and talk about it. So we found a black pilot because a kid said he wanted to be a pilot. And we just showed people jobs, and then we realized we had to take them to places. So we took them to hotels, we took them to theater, we tried to expose them. So all of that was sort of, got me into the administrative role and organizing it. But mainly I think it's the passion of being of service to people, which is from my church background, and we're so rich in talent, why don't we have these organizations or something to support that?
Todd, I'm gonna pick up on two threads that I heard from Chris and Candelaria. I think it sort of got me to where became an arts administrator. I think one interesting connection that Chris and I had, I also thought I was gonna go to law school in college. I was actually the president of the Hanna Free Law Society, and I think that was thinking about how could I be of service to some sort of society. Law seems like a potentially a good way, right? But then I decided not to follow that path. I actually worked with adjudicated youth in between undergrad and graduate school, and I got a degree in theology. So again, sort of trying to find my way, maybe of some type of service to the world or to the community. And then I had an opportunity to work at the Boston Youth Symphony Orchestras, and I think again, what clicked for me was that connection of how the arts can sort of make a greater impact on not only young people, but the world in general. And I think, this career and this passion for helping other people find their own passions, sort of fills that opportunity to help people and provide a way for people to, find their own voice, find their own level of creativity or expertise and things like that. So what Candelaria was saying about service, I think for probably many of us, arts is not only a passion and a craft, but also, a way to give back. So I think that's what I would add.
Yeah, I think the spark that got me was that I had my father's best friend found an old record in his collection, and it was actually Ma Rainey's Black Bottom on record, and I'd never heard anything like it. And I sat there and was like, oh man, this is amazing, because I'd taken a few theater classes at that point, and I said, this sounds like my family, this sounds like all my family in Southern Ohio, and the rhythms, and the joy, and the pain, and all of that. So that, I went to go, after I heard that record, then I went to go see a production of Two Trains Running, and I sat in the audience and said, and it was Larry Fishburne Byrne and Roscoe V. Brown doing a monologue. I said, I need to do this. I need to do this. And I think that was, the seed was planted about being an actor. And I said, someday I'm going to meet August Wilson, and I'm going to talk to him and tell him how important his work is. And I did get to meet him in graduate school, and then I did get my first professional performing gig at the Penumbra Theater in Minneapolis, where he got much of his start. So it was just being inspired and just having that one family member or family friend say, I can't really do anything with this, but you may be able to make something out of it. And from that moment, I was able to make something out of it. And I think for me, that service always comes back to, yeah, I want to serve a community, but whenever I walk into a room with students, particularly, I'm looking for that one kid who may have been like me, and I know where there's 1,000 kids, there's probably way more than one, so I'm always searching that kid out and trying to be in service to that person. And the hope is that you know, there's osmosis among the group.
Thank you. So this next question is for Candelaria and Ben. Both of you decided to stay in Boston after moving here for school. What progress, if any, have you seen in terms of diversity and inclusion?
Tough question, right? Some facts. I came here in 1996 for undergrad, sort of left for a little bit of time, as I mentioned, to do some work with some adjudicated youth. Came back 2001, two. But since, you know, about that time, you know, certainly, obviously, I think most of us recognize the conversation around issues of diversity and inclusion, you know, have grown. You know, so I, as you sort of picked up, I grew up in southern New Jersey, a rural part of New Jersey. You know, I was one of two Asians in my high school and things like that. So coming to college and to Boston really sort of opened up the door in a lot of ways to a lot of different people in diversity. So, you know, I think for me, college was that door. So that's one thing. And I think in terms of, you know, as I entered the arts sector back in 2003, you know, there was some preliminary, you know, understanding. I think it's sort of, so when I worked with Boston Youth New Yorkers, I want to try to give specific examples because I think that's helpful. You know, they still have a program called the ICP program, the Intensive Community Program, and that was geared towards, you know, reaching underrepresented youth in classical music, right? And, you know, started out small and, you know, got more funding and grew and things like that. So in terms of my own experience, kind of recognizing one, sort of person new to classical music a little bit, and then understanding the racial and power dynamics of, you know, classical music, at least in my place of employment, a program that they were trying to grow and run was a way for me to kind of begin to understand that, like, there's work to be done for folks to have access and whatnot. And since then, as I've gone to other organizations, in particular Boston Children's Chorus, I mean, all her organization is geared towards being all encompassing and welcoming. But I think generally as a sector and as a, you know, community, there's just been way more conversations happening, people sort of trying to understand what they can do to be more inclusive, to understand their blind spots and things like that, and understand things like privilege. And so I think, you know, through this conversation and the other conversations that Arts Boston is going to hold, kind of try to unpack that a little bit. But obviously it's complex and, you know, it's a journey, right? Candelaria, what have you seen?
Well, I think that just being in this room with this many people in this art center is evidence of incredible progress, but it's like we're having some of the best of times and the worst of times at the same time. I'm a person who's always sorted for the good, always found my people, the tribe of good people, and always did a lot of cultural stuff. But when I first came to Boston, I literally could see pretty much every play in Boston. Now I can't. There are so many theater groups. There's not enough strong black theater, although people are working to make that happen, that have a physical home. I think Boston was a raggedy, dirty city. You can't even imagine how different it is. And so there were neighborhoods that I did not go in. I was around. My son was growing up when the Charles Stewart murder happened, and they were questioning a lot of black men and some black young men about that and being really oppressive. So we certainly, I can walk in virtually every neighborhood here and feel comfortable. I can walk in virtually every neighborhood here and see other people of color, even though it, you know, we know from the report of the Global Center, if it's a seaport, they don't live there. They might be working. But so that's the parallel of Boston, that you have more diversity in some ways than ever, and yet you still can, you can live a very blacks only life here, you can live a very whites only life here, you can live a very Chinese only life here, a Vietnamese only life here, if that's your choice. And I really stayed, I had decided to leave here, and then I met my husband, my second husband, and I was like, oh, well, if this doesn't work out. he actually did my website for ACT Roxbury right before the Roxbury Film Festival and asked me out a week after the film festival, and I literally told my daughter, I told her I was moving back to Charlotte, I was tired of Boston, if this doesn't work out, and then he's never gonna leave, he's a Bostonian, so that's sort of why I stayed. But I found my tribe here, and I found things that I can do, but I'm not uncritical because particularly in terms of ownership, I think I would tell, one thing I just wanna say while it's on my mind is that if you can't own in Boston, then go own in Detroit and Jackson, even if you live in Boston, find something in New Hampshire, Maine. Owning and looking in retrospect, despite redlining, I wish that we had more of a consciousness of the importance of owning buildings, right? If you own your space, you have so much more leverage and control than when you don't. So places that were undesirable became desirable, and now a lot of people are priced out, and that's one of the things that really, really worries me about Boston.
I just have one more thing to add, and something that Kendall already that you said. I think that the art sector in Boston, there's a lot of organizations, and I'm not so sure about other parts of the country, because I haven't lived there or worked there. But I'm honored to be in this room and then in a sector where there are a lot of arts organizations that care deeply about issues of race, social justice, and things like that. And I've been as a part of Boston Children's Chorus, part of the Boston Cultural Change Network that came out of the Boston Foundation. And you know, like this network, you know, a network of organizations that connected people and organizations together that cared about these things. And that started maybe 4 years ago. So I think for me personally, if I didn't live in Boston and then I didn't get into this sector, quite honestly, it very well could have been possible. If I went to law school, right, got my law degree, worked at a fancy law firm, I may be very not as, I don't want to use the word woke, but I mean, as conscious as I am about these issues because of the path I took through the arts, quite honestly. So. I think for me, I'm you know, blessed to have gotten to where I am in this journey because of the arts and the arts organizations in Boston.
Sticking with the two of you and that question, you kind of just touched on that, Ben. Who do you think are some of the organizations in the city that are doing the work and doing it well? And it's okay to say if it's yourself or your organization.
You know, for me, it's a both and. I think certainly Arts Boston has taken a lead by doing whatever it took to attract Vicki George and finding a way to support her vision. And I know, so what has to happen is that this can't be a project. It has to become an organization. And it has to figure out how to exist so that if Vicki goes away, if Arts Boston goes away or has new leadership, it doesn't go away. And I think that's what I mean by ownership. I think a lot of organizations, the Darkroom Collective?
Front Porch
Arts Collective, that was Darkroom, it was another organization.
Front Porch Network.
They're doing something. But I think it depends on whether you're talking about really big institutions or not. At the Huntington, the community membership program that I'm in the sixth year of, but there have been times when there have been only maybe three people of color who work in the whole organization. So even though they're trying, and even though they did all of August Wilson's plays except for one while he was alive and all of that, in terms of who actually gets a paycheck, you know, so, and then we expand and now there might be 11. But then in another year you go back to being 3 or 4. And people, in some ways they're trying, and I think lots of groups are trying with different things, but one of my frustrations is seeing people do things now that we did 30 years ago, but for some reason it didn't hold. So I think there are a lot of efforts, but I think that figuring out how to create not just diversity, but inclusion and parity. Parity is a word that I'm looking. You know, like if the Huntington, if Lyric Stage, if the Symphony made, say, the next 50 hires were people of color, if that were some of the goals, that would be, for me, really exciting. In Boston, and from St. Louis, I grew up with black doctors. I always had black teachers. So to come to Boston and go to a public school and found out there were no people of color in some of them, to go to Boston City Hospital, which is now Boston Medical Center, and at that time, less than, on one hand, you could count the number of black doctors, it just blew my mind. So a lot of institutions in Boston still can be very white and are still very fragile in terms of the numbers of people of color. And so I can't think of one organization that's got it right. I think there are a lot of organizations that are trying, but I can't think of one that I would say, well, this is the exemplar. And you might say one, and I'll say, oh yeah, I forgot about that. Because I'm also old, so you are correct.
I think one way to look at this is it's like a chicken and egg problem. Right? And we're the Network for Arts Administrators. And so is there representation in the arts leaders of organizations, right? So that's kind of one thing over here. And then the other thing that kind of Laurie was talking a little bit about, which I do think the Huntington has tried, and during the 6 year of doing this and making it accessible is, audiences. And this is the business of Arts Boston, right? Are audiences diverse, and why or why not? So for instance, at a sort of a much larger and a level of presenting, Arts Emerson, I think, has made some strides towards programming and presenting work that's going to attract different audiences. And they've also, invested in terms of the staff, and from what I can tell, sort of programmatically of reaching out and creating programs that are going to meet people where they're at and their interests, right? So they have this book, a book club, it doesn't just meet downtown, it goes out.
The Play Reading Book Club, and I actually am a program manager for the fund that funds it at the Dudley Library. So, oops, Arts Emerson, I'm sorry.
and I think the example Candelaria brought up about, Arts Boston and Vicky. So I would say, and I don't know all the inner workings, but I remember when Vicky was first hired and came here to Arts Boston. And I think I heard her conversation that new person, Vicky, she's interested in this network. And like getting that jump started, and look, she made it happen. But I, would that happen if Vicky didn't come here? I don't know. Or if they didn't hire a person of color, maybe not. And so I think it's a good example of when you have that representation in cultural organizations or on your team, new and different and good things could happen that you might not know happen until you put the right people in place.
Yes,
right?
Exactly.
So I think it's a little bit of a chicken and egg for different organizations. And I know some of these other talks are going to get into, so the nuances of cultural organizations that are predominantly present white culture or white art forms versus arts organizations that are, predominantly cultural or organized by communities of color. Because I think there's definitely a difference there. And is it a question of diversity and inclusion? Because I think you can have that at a organization that's predominantly sort of white culture or sort of Western art form, because I think all art is for everybody, right? But again, it's about who's in charge and all these kinds of details.
I would be remiss if I didn't mention the Elma Lewis School and Center that used to be here, and the Museum of the National Center of Afro-American Artists still exists. Black Nativity is going on. It ends this weekend. It's in its 44th or 45th year, and they're trying. If they finally get the designation, they will have across from Rumble Station, a new museum, and they'll be able to return to doing the things that the Elmer Lewis Center did. But again, the infrastructure for arts organizations of color has been real difficult to maintain in Boston for a variety of reasons.
Thank you for that. Now, Chris, we're not going to leave you out.
Yeah.
Chris, you were gainfully employed in Nevada, and now you've moved to Boston. So you've been here for about 3 months now, right?
Yeah, or give or take.
So in your short time here, what is your perspective on diversity and inclusion in the arts in Boston?
Well,
and also compared to other cities that you've lived in.
Relative to Las Vegas, this wouldn't happen. Matter of fact, you couldn't even get all the artists in the same room. Black, white, green, whatever color, or culture, or gender. It's just not vibrant in that way. I was at a university that's first or second most diverse university in the country. But these sort of conversations are just not happening in the States or in the city. And the arts community there is just now coming to a place where they can come to a room and talk. Theater by itself, just recently, it's just started within the last, I would say, 2 years, we're starting to talk. Visual arts, probably within the last 3 to 4 years. So this feels like a cherry to me relative to Las Vegas. New York, you know, it feels very similar to Boston. The thing about New York, I would say, in my experience, is that it seems like, though art seems to be moving from New York across the country, across the provinces, I get a sense that the Boston intellectual sensibility is actually maybe driving this conversation a little more than I think you all give yourselves credit for. And I would say, as a newcomer here, and I'm really loving it here, so hopefully I'll be able to say that we are giving ourselves credit for in a few years. But these conversations, from the moment I hit the ground here, I found folks are willing, able, and want to have these conversations. Folks in Actors Shakespeare Project, actors around town that I've spoken to, Victoria, we were in contact literally 2 weeks after I landed here. So I think you can, I don't want to say give yourselves a pat on the back, but I think you can know that I think you're probably on the forefront of this in the country as a group trying to make a difference. I don't know about the infrastructure of the institutions in Boston, but this energy in this room right now, and the energy of just the little bit I've talked to you guys on the phone and in the other room is certainly palpable. So I would give yourselves a little more credit.
Todd, I was just gonna just add, and you sort of said we could sort of pat ourselves on the back a little bit. I'd be remiss to, you know, not mention Boston Children's Chorus, which many people are familiar with. And just to say that, so BCC is celebrating its 15th anniversary, so we're founded in 2003. I like to tell people it's the same age as the Lenny's Acom Bridge, which, you know, has its significance as well for Boston. But originally, you know, it was founded by not a musician, a social worker, again, person who was giving his, you know, career towards the service of others, Hubie Jones. But really, in the DNA of the organization was the mission of bringing diverse and being diverse and being inclusive and being welcoming of all people and using arts as a tool, right? And I think people use theater as a tool to accomplish this. People use dance to do this. But in terms of an actual organization that needs to, as a business model, need to raise money and hire people, you know, at the very core was, again, this DNA to be inclusive. And I think sometimes, in many cases, organizations, arts organizations, they're coming at it sort of down the road about how to be diverse and inclusive, right? It's not at the center, it's not at the beginning. You know, an organization that was founded, you know, in 1850 in Boston was not thinking about being diverse and inclusive, right? And so, you know, they're on a journey, as I've said before. But I think for us, you know, you look at the Boston Globe thing where they're counting people. If you went to a BCC concert this past weekend, you know, the numbers would have astounded the Globe reporters about how diverse it was. But very intentional, very top of mind, et cetera.
There's one other thing I would want to say. There is one of the organizations I've worked with who seems to have a sense of this in a very strong way is the Oregon Shakespeare Festival in Ashland, Oregon. They really pressed this. And I think the challenge is that whatever your genre, whatever your organization is, that we sometimes tend to silo ourselves and say, hey, I want to be diverse for the Boston area, or I want to be diverse for Roxbury or Jamaica Plain or whatever it is. But Oregon has taken the approach that they're in a very small town in Ashland, Oregon, but they're trying to make their company reflective of the United States. And I think that's a way to look at it, because I think what happens is folks get afraid that they're going to alienate the base that they have. But if we're all, you know, if we're all Americans and it's a melting pot of people from different countries, let's try to reflect the country that we're in, not just the streets, the neighborhood, or the city that we are in. And I think Oregon has really been very successful around that.
This question is for Ms. Candelaria. So you told us earlier an interesting story about a career challenge that you experienced that you weren't expecting. Can you share that story with everyone else in the audience tonight?
Is that the one about that we talked about on the phone?
Yes. Okay.
There are actually two, and they're kind of related. I found out while I was at Roxbury, I was at Roxbury for 9.5 years, and I did just so many programs that you can't even imagine. And I was often, I was on the Arts Services Coalition with Catherine Peterson. I was the only person of color on that, I was often the only white person in the room. Anyhow, I found out by accident, this woman, somehow it came up and she says, oh, there was a job that came up that it was with the city, and that they decided, they were talking about me and coming to me and asking me if I wanted to apply to this job, but they decided not to because I was doing so well in Roxbury with At Roxbury. And I said, so a group of people who never said anything to me talked about me and decided that I was doing so well in Roxbury and with At Roxbury that I should stay there. And nobody ever talked to me. And it was going to be another zero in my salary, I found out. And then I also had that happen to me when my first husband had died and I was a single parent, where there was an opportunity to travel. And somebody said, well, she has young children, so no, she can't do that. But nobody had come to me. And and finding that out later, people making decisions about your place. So I always tell people that where I sit is not always where I stand. And my vision, I thought Roxbury was a location, and I spread the word about what we were doing very widely. It was never just Roxbury-centric, because not being from Boston, I didn't have the neighborhood thing. I did things here that I didn't know, oops, they don't go there, and we are not supposed to go there. I didn't have that. I thought, it's a part of Boston. I never thought, I think that's sometimes an advantage when you come from a different place. I saw this richness in Mattapan. I didn't know that people in Cambridge didn't always come over to Roxbury. I didn't know all those stupid divisions, so I didn't pay attention to them. But people do, I was so visible that people, there was somebody talking about me who denied an opportunity to me. So I think that when I tell young people on the other end of it, or people who are still active in their career, I'm at another stage in my life, is that opportunity comes when it's gonna come and you should follow it. So if you work someplace for 2 weeks and this once in a lifetime opportunity comes along, you gave them a good 2 weeks, go for it. Because I've lived long enough where certain opportunities that you let go because you say I'm being loyal and I haven't been here a year yet, it never comes back. Sometimes another better opportunity, but sometimes it doesn't. So I think that people should not ever limit us, and I don't want to limit myself. Everything I've ever done, I didn't know how to do a film festival. I didn't know, but I knew I had gotten money and I could figure out how to do it. And I knew there were filmmakers and knew there were places to show film and okay, and let's put a committee together and da 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 da. You know, so it really hurt me. And the same thing is that if you create, institutions can create criteria for things and then they won't recreate them. So the other painful experience I had where my name was put forward to get the substantial financial grant, and then they went on the technicality that I wasn't exactly the executive director. Mm-hmm. So my program was part of the Madison Park Development Corporation. It was called Act Roxbury. I wrote the grants, I created the board, I did everything that the organization did, but that was the technicality that ended up costing me the stipend. So my thing was, if you can create the criteria for the stipend, you can decide this is an exceptional case. Let's do that. So sometimes people box you. And so what I try to do is never box myself and to never absorb those messages. But those were blows that sort of, it hurt. I will say it hurt, yeah.
Thank you for sharing those experiences. You touched upon how you worked through it, but what were some other ways that you worked through those challenges?
Well, letting people know that I'm interested in everything. I mean, I really am a person who loves everything. I like all kinds of music. I like dancing. I'm a writer. I love the idea of being of service and the idea that arts are healing. Arts are incredibly healing. In the community outreach we've done as the Huntington Theater Program, we have people who are in homeless shelters, we have people who have suffered trauma, who are actually coming to theater as a way of healing them. I think that we have to push beauty and culture and art in the same way that people push drugs and consumerism and racism and stupidity. So I've become less passive and not assuming that people know. I think you share. So one of the things I do is I share, people know I have all these email lists and I share information about, you know, I have information for artists, for photographers, for parents of young children, for parents of middle school. Lacolian is here, he'll tell you, get emails from me about the things that are going on. I think you share information. I think you sometimes give people feedback quietly and privately on how they think they can up their game. I think you have to be willing to be the only black person or Chinese person or Vietnamese person or, you know, Puerto Rican person in the room and not be afraid of that. And when you do get certain opportunities, because I've also had other opportunities where I said, oh, they asked me, I'm not prepared. And I have to say, a lot of people did a whole lot so that Candelaria Silva could be in the place to be in this room. And if I am invited into that room, I belong there. And I have to not have the self-doubt, because sometimes I have been paralyzed with self-doubt and feeling that I wasn't worthy. And then finding out years later that you had more people attend your events than these other people that you thought you had up there, because I'm a scrapper. I said, I'm not very elegant and in sort of my background, but the brain works and the creativity and the vision is there. And so I've had to often not ignore the fact that I belong in all the rooms that I'm invited to. But I don't want to be alone, so I'm always trying to get other people invited as well.
Just from sitting up here with all of you, I feel like I'm taking in as I'm hearing each of you speak, but personally, as a young person of color in the arts, just now starting my arts administrative journey, trying to figure out if I want to go the leadership route or what steps I should take to get towards that leadership track. What is some advice that you can give to myself and other people in the audience on how to climb the ladder?
I think this network is a good start, because what I would say is, you know, creating and having a network. So when I was starting out in my career, I think, you know, the idea of what a mentor was or a network of people was very foreign to me. And quite honestly, it wasn't till many years later, like the concept of, you know, having a mentor or mentors, you know, sort of appeared in sort of my professional development. So I think people are much more savvy now and more sort of educated, and so I think it's a little bit more common. And I think like this network in Arts Boston and the work they're doing, you know, helps facilitate that a lot more. Because I think, you know, to combat this being the only in a lot of situations, you know, having that network to fall back on, whether they're your peers, whether in different art forms, different art organizations, or, you know, having the people that have sort of paved the way for us. You know, obviously there's a great, a lot of learning, sort of not on the job learning that you can get from those conversations. And I would just say my personal sort of challenge is sometimes sort of just the same as Kendall Art, is that I've had doubt. I've had opportunities to kind of step up and I didn't feel like I was ready. And sort of trying to analyze that, I'm not sure why, other than my own sort of, you know, lack of self-confidence at the moment. I would say at the time, you know, I was always grateful to be where I was at and give it 110%. And I think, you know, for anybody, hopefully you're measured on the merits of your effort and how much you care about the work that you're doing, et cetera. And I was fortunate that, you know, those opportunities were still there for me. I think partly that's because of the work I did, but also I think there are people out there who, you know, look out for you and want to support you, and you just sort of have to make those connections.
I guess I'll piggyback off of that. I think find yourself a mentor, because I think far too often young leaders, and sometimes leaders of color, do not know what resources there are out there, whether it's an executive coach, a mentor, or a psychologist, whatever, you know. Find someone that you can talk to, someone that you can share with. Sometimes that's your partner, maybe it's someone outside of your circle. Another thing I think is important is that I really believe people who believe in the company that they're in, and in that they're willing to put whatever company they work for, they've decided to be with that company for a reason. 9 times out of 10, that reason is for the mission. And if you show yourself to be a person who is willing to put the mission before yourself in the context of when you're on that job, I think that outs. I think that truth outs, and people notice that. If you can be on mission and be working for the company's best interest instead of your own best interest, or, you know, where you want to be in 5 years, you can have all those thoughts and you can move through all those things. But when you're at the job, be about the job. And then the other thing I would say, this is something that always goes back to me, and this is something my father told me. He was a military man. He's retired now, but he would say in a very sort of gruff way, lead, follow, or get out of the way. And I think you get to make that choice every day, what you do. And you can be in control, you can be the executive director, and you can still follow, right? You don't have to take the onus of feeling like you have to have all the answers to every single question. That's why I think great leaders put smart people around them. I think that's what Barack Obama did, and he was pretty smart too. So lead, follow, or get out of the way, and it goes across the board, from the very bottom rung to the top.
I've never been formally mentored, and a lot of people who have mentored me from my observing them. I've known for thank you notes, and I'm known for sending sympathy cards, goodwill cards, congratulation cards. I've written people who I read a profile of in the Globe and never met them, and I've sent them a congratulations to come to Boston if you'd like to, you know, go out to lunch or dinner sometime. I mean, I just really want to do that. But the guy who I learned to do that from was, I think, Daniel Cheever. I don't know if he's still alive. He was the superintendent of the Western Public Schools, where I worked for the METCO program. And I did one of my first presentations, which was really horrible, but I was really passionate. So, but I hadn't done an outline, sort of winged it. I learned not to do that. But he sent me a very lovely thank you note that was in my box the morning after I did the presentation. And I realized he, and then I read a book by Terry Williams, who owned the top black marketing agency in the country, and she said, you know, keep a stationary store at your desk so that you can always send notes. So these are people that I, you know, when I meet an observer, I enter, I say, I like the way her hair is. I wonder how she does. I like the way she, okay, when she came up to the podium, you know, or he did this, and let me see if I can do that style, because a lot of times people won't consciously mentor you. I would also say in terms of if you know about an opportunity, share it. If you're applying for the opportunity, give yourself a day or two lead, and then share it. The reason that you want to share it is that you may not get it, but if somebody you know got it, then there's going to be opportunities for you. Third is sometimes the people who you're looking for help for and you expect them to support you are not the people that you think you've given to. But somebody over there was watching you and an opportunity comes. And finally, I would say, figure out how to get visible with search firms. There are a lot of search firms and letting people know that you're looking. If you need to do it confidentially, you can write that in your note. But getting visible with a lot of search firms, there's a lot of opportunities both in Boston and in other cities, but the search firms don't always find you, so you have to say, here I am. And that's, again, growing up in church, being egotistical is what they would say. There's always that tension. But if you don't do here I am, sometimes people won't know who you are. So you gotta be visible.
I just wanted to add what Chris was saying, because I think for me, you know, as you kind of maybe picked up a little bit, I didn't really know what I was going to do. The track to be a doctor or whatever. I was trying to just find my way, right? And I think wherever I got, you know, I really sort of dedicated myself to whatever that job is. And I never really, I would say, had a really strategic plan. I think wherever I was doing the best job that I could. And I'd say, you know, I have this kind of big sort of long title now, executive producer, blah, 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 blah. But, you know, really, my number one job, and I did it this past weekend in the snow, is to make sure the kids who are getting out of their cars to get to the concert see someone they know, smiling face, and they get to where they need to go. Because I understand when you're coming into Boston, you don't know where it's happening, and snowing, you kind of drop your kid off, and double parking, and blah, blah, blah. The best thing that you could see is someone that you know smiling and helping your kid to, you know, off the curb. And that's my number one job. You know, obviously I gotta raise money and talk to people and whatever, but, you know, so people do see that, I think, and they know that you're not, you know, too good to do this, that, or the other thing. And it, you know, quite honestly, it got me that big title. I do my work.
Yes.
So, your job.
Yeah. The other thing I would add is that, when I grew up, I'm mixed race. My mother's British. My father's African American. And I'll keep it real. I know that I could walk through the door and be Latinx if I so chose, but I don't. So when I was growing up, my father said, you will have to work twice as hard. And then what you do is you take that into the world with, well, at least I did, I take that into the world with me, and that twice became 3 to 4 times as hard. So the only thing I would say is we have to allow ourselves, give ourselves a break and know that we have picked up some knowledge along the way, and reading into that a little bit, and, you know, like Ben says, that specter of insecurity and doubt will be there, and can you just sit in the chair and let it sit with you for a minute and not let it drive you? So give yourself a break in that way.
Yeah. Thank you. More questions for all of our panelists. So, for each of you this evening. So, now that you've shared everything and you've answered all these questions, what are the next steps for the city of Boston and specifically for the arts and nonprofit sector? What are some key tools and strategies that different organizations can look forward to and really should take advantage of?
Interestingly enough, last week there was a board meeting around the theater. A group of theaters got together and talked about diversity, inclusion in the boards. I think diversifying the board is a big step, because a lot of times the access is just not afforded because the person who's coming in at a high level, a high executive level, is not able to connect with those folks that would be hiring them. So I think diversifying the board and then allowing there to be a cross-section of folks on the board, or really recruiting that cross-section, and I don't just mean race, obviously, gender fluidity, accessibility, all of those things, because that's just the way that we're moving. And then supporting supporting people of color, because sometimes, let's be real, we get through the door sometimes and we forgot the door that we came through. Remember the door you came through and support the people that are coming up.
Well said.
You go.
I mean, there's so much. I can give a very specific example outside of the arts sector, just on this topic of helping support, you know, arts administrators of color in the sector. The Girl Scouts, Big Sisters in Boston. Some of you guys might have heard the executive director speak at the Boston Foundation's talk on a report that just came out. They, you know, were concerned. They went into increase the diversity of folks that were part of their staff and serving, you know, primarily young women of color. So a lot of organizations, you know, as you were saying, the schools teaching young people of color but have no people of color teaching, right? So they kind of took a look at this issue, like, what is the barrier? And so for them, it was their big sisters or the staff needed to have a master's in social work. And so what they realized was, and we can go through all the reasons why it's a challenge for people of color to have higher education or have, you know, the top, you know, top school, private schools and all that kind of stuff. But they said, okay, what we're seeing is there's a lot of qualified people out there who can do this work well, but they don't have a master's degree. So why are we setting a barrier for them to have a master's degree? So they changed the hiring process. They, you know, they had other, you know, check boxes for qualifications, and so, you know, turned it all around in terms of the, you know, people that they could attract. They also talked about living wage. I mean, that's a whole other conversation, right? You know, to find qualified people and keep them so that they weren't doing five other jobs or whatever the case may be. So that's a very tactical, specific thing that even arts organizations, I think, you know, we get sort of not trapped, but we think about, we have to find the best, the highly qualified person. And if our networks aren't diverse, you know, we find, even if we're sort of blind with the resume and the names and stuff, well, we're looking for the best private colleges or the best, you know, arts training programs, and like the numbers show who go to those programs, right? So who are you gonna get? So you gotta really think differently about how you wanna engage and hire people, because until you get the Vickies of the world and the Chris's of the world and the Kendall Arias and give them the opportunity, your organization's not gonna figure out the next new thing that's gonna really be transformative. So that's sort of a very specific example outside of the art sector, but it is sort of reflective, I think, on arts organizations and when we're trying to hire.
Yeah. I think it's like, what I think about is when computers, I'm old enough to remember when computers sort of came to the workplace, and there was a lot of resistance, because at that time, you had no code to use computers, and so people were terrified. And organizations didn't say, oh, this is a choice. Computers are going to be part of this organization. They're going to be totally part of our lives. None of them knew then that they were going to be have little mini computers in our pockets called smartphones. But there wasn't a choice. And I think diversity and inclusion has to be the same thing. That if we decide that this, as a sector, this is what is going to happen, it means it has to be from the trustees all the way down to the volunteers and the box office. That everybody needs training. That you have to, every time you have a job opening, you have to say, we're not going to fill the job until we've interviewed a diverse range of candidates. That you can, a lot of times, if you can hire personality and energy and have people show you how they would approach problems, then you can train them on some of the specifics of the actual organization. But you can't train a personality. You can't train eagerness. I've read more than all of my friends who have PhDs, because I read 2 to 3 books a week, and I have done it all of my life. So, and I always used to say, let me get an interview. If I can get an interview, I can convince them. And the other thing is, I think that you have to mentor people in the sector. And so I will say that I have a colleague, and I mentioned the fact that a board that I'm on, Dunamis Boston, is looking to expand their board. And I said, I would like to recommend you. And he wrote me back to say he didn't think he had anything to offer. And I wrote him back, these are the things that you have to offer. And in doing that, I helped him see himself in a different light, that some people don't see themselves as the material for certain jobs. So if you're with somebody who doesn't have the self-awareness, or is modest, or is quiet, or is whatever they are, sometimes being a mentor and saying, look, this is how I think you should apply for this. This is why I think you should do this. And then I'm always telling, like, I do a lot of work with the Arts and Business Council, and they have a Business on Board section, and I'm always suggesting people to them, and let's, I won't do the monthly meetings for that cohort and everybody be white. Okay, we're gonna have some different, because there are people, if it's a program for artists of color and none of the speakers of artists of color, don't you see that you're sending a message? Now, that doesn't mean I don't have white presenters, because I do. But it means that they can't be the only ones, because I'm not gonna send that. It's the same way I do when I used to run programs and evaluate programs. If they didn't have any male students involved in arts programs, I'd say this is unacceptable. Because it was so top-heavy with women. There are boys out here who are talented. Let's go find some. We're going to have to recruit them in different ways. So I think you have to be very, very, very active, and I think you have to decide, if this sector can't be diverse and inclusive, who else can be? If the artists can't figure it out, artists figure things out. Artists make a way out of no way. Artists, sometimes if you go to the rehearsal, the dress rehearsal, you wonder how in the heck and what happens on opening night? What happens? We do it, right? So if we can't figure out how to do this and reflect our country, and I love what you said, our whole world, nobody else will do it. So I think we're going to have to bring that creativity and that never give up spirit. And I also, the final thing is, I'm hoping that the marijuana legalization profits will, we can somehow funnel them into arts and education.
Still in tax achievements. Still in tax achievements.
But there has to be a way that we can make that happen.
I got two quick ones, because I know we're pressed for time, but I think I heard of a theater recently that made an edict that they, within their design staff, meaning the set designer, costume designer, sound designer, they will not hire any more homogenized groups. They just won't do it. They have to be all from different backgrounds, and they can't all be from Yale. Maybe in Boston it's Harvard, I don't know. The other thing is, I think another thing that would be helpful is if people start looking at outreach as not a one-night stand, but a relationship. A lot of times people look at, well, if we go to, I brought up the like Hibernian Hall thing, if we do our show at Hibernian Hall, we put our art up at Hibernian Hall,
sorry. Right.
it's outreach to, folks of color. Well, it needs to be a relationship. That's something that needs to be started a year and a half to 2 years out, so that there's a relationship leading up to the moment, and then what happens when you leave? How do you follow up? And that's hard, time-consuming work, and that has to be done.
Well, can we get a round of applause for all of our I want to thank Ben and Candelaria and Chris for sharing your insight. just for sharing your stories with all of us this evening. It's been a delight to hear from each of you, so seriously, thank you. Now, on to other people that we need to thank. So a huge thank you to Cynthia Wu and Karthik Subramanian. Hey, I'm so sorry about that. And the Power Arts Center for hosting us. Also, thank you to HowlRound for partnering with the network to live stream the series. A recorded version of this conversation will be available on HowlRound TV, so be looking for the link. Finally, we want to thank Bank of America for their continued support in sustaining the network for arts administrators of color. Also, the part that you've all been waiting for now, please join us in the gallery for a small reception, and we hope to see you at the next conversation in February. Thank you.